Every year, 68 teams compete. Fans bet $9.7 billion on 70 million different brackets, all to find out who will be the champions. What does it take to be on the winning team?
Well, praise the Lord. Do we have any basketball fans in the house? Two. Okay, well, I just got to be completely transparent here, you know. I mean, I'm pretty enthusiastic about a lot of things and pretty easily excited, but basketball's not one of them. No, I like playing hoops on the court, but, you know, I never did well at basketball, and it wasn't because I wasn't athletic. I just was a little more aggressive than what basketball players appreciated, and I didn't understand that. I thought it was a full contact sport, you know? I mean, like, isn't tackling allowed on the court? You know, don't they go together? But my friends and my basketball player buddies, they did not appreciate my flavor and style of basketball. So anyway, you know, I got more into football and wrestling and that kind of thing. And, you know, to me, basketball players, and I'm not insulting anyone, but I'm just saying, you know, if you just touch them wrong, they're like, foul! And I'm going, what's wrong with you? You know, foul, that's something you shoot in the air, you know, bang, bang, bang. But, you know, I didn't get that every little touch and every little push or shove, you know, it just seemed if you're on the court and you're running around, you're going to bump into each other. You know what I'm saying? So my friends, you know, similar to Justin's story, as he shared last week, I was frequently the last guy picked. But again, it wasn't because I wasn't as athletic. It was just as simple as I didn't play the game the way everybody else played it. I was used to, like, backyard football, backyard basketball, and they didn't really enjoy playing with me too much. So here's the thing. What was the breakdown? What was the problem? It wasn't that I couldn't play basketball. It was that I didn't really know how, right? I did not understand the rules of the game. I didn't understand what you could do, what you couldn't do. I knew the objective was get the ball through the net. And since I'm a whatever it takes kind of guy, you know, hey, whatever it takes, I'm going to put that ball through that net. And you can see that we believe here at Open Arms wholeheartedly that Jesus is a whatever it takes kind of guy. He gave it all, right? And so that's in our core values. However, there are rules to the game, right? And if you're going to be a quality team member, if you're going to be a winning team, well, then you've got to know those rules. You've got to know the objective of the game. You got to know how the game is played, and you got to know what are the qualities of a winning team. And not only what are the qualities of the winning team, but a team is composed of players. So what are the qualities of a winning player, right? We saw last week that unlike what commonly happens in many of our sports activities, you know, we get selected, and some of us were the last to be selected, and some of us, we just don't even make the team, right? Well, with God, we saw that God wants everyone to be on his team, right? So notice in your outlines, in Matthew chapter 28, it says, "Then Jesus came to them and said, 'All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age.'" So notice that, first of all, Jesus shows up and he says, listen, I am the man. I am the authority on heaven and on earth. It's all been given to me now. And birthed out of that truth, birthed out of that reality, I'm inviting you to join my team. Therefore, he says, and the question is, what is therefore, therefore? Do you understand what I'm saying? He says, therefore, in other words, because all authority in heaven and earth have been given to me, do these things. And so this invitation really isn't an invitation at all. It's actually a command for anybody who would call themselves a follower of Jesus this day. So we notice that God expects everybody to be on the team, and he expects everybody to be a playmaker. Therefore, because of who Jesus is, because of what he has accomplished, we are to go and make disciples of all nations, right? He has clearly defined that every member, every believer is a team member. Every team member is expected to grow and mature. Notice he says, teaching them to obey, meaning that we grow up into the understanding of who God is and what he's done for us and how it applies to our life. Every member is expected to contribute. Notice that it wasn't a few select people go. Those of you that are called to be missionaries, you go and make disciples. Those of you that are called to be pastors or apostles or prophets, you go and teach people about Jesus. Notice that Jesus never qualified that this command was isolated only to church leadership. This is for anyone who believes that Jesus Christ is the supreme authority, which, by the way, is what we're saying when we say Jesus is Lord. The word Lord means master or supreme authority. So if you are a believer, if you and I believe that Jesus is the authority, then we need to submit to that authority and be not only a team member, but a contributing team member. He said, go. We are, as disciples, to go and make disciples. Discipleship is not isolated to the acquiring of information. I want to make that clear. Unfortunately, in many churches, we have left the telling and the advancement of the kingdom of God strictly to church leadership, which is wrong. And the other thing that we've done is we have isolated and relegated true discipleship to be nothing more than the accumulation of information. As I acquire a greater degree of understanding of the Bible, then I am more and more a disciple. But that is not true. The fact is that a disciple is someone who lives those truths. A disciple is not just a student, not just a pupil or learner, but someone who takes those teachings and embraces them as their life. And so they become a follower of the master. Notice that the disciples that were with Jesus, they didn't go to class once a week to learn what it meant to be a disciple of Jesus. They lived with him day in and day out. They not only listened to his teachings, but they were held accountable to applying those teachings. This is very different than perhaps how we're used to viewing discipleship in our Western culture, where we think of church as just go to church on Sunday, hear a message. You know, it might be a guilt one or it might be a pep-me-up one, but in the end, they all have the same effect. I file them in the filing cabinet of my mind somewhere to collect dust as I go about my life from day to day, doing as I see best, right? Making a few moral changes, trying to be a better person, right? Are you tracking with me so far? And then hoping it all works out. When things get a little tight, I pray. I do my little prayers or daily readings to, you know, show that I am still in the club. God, don't forget me, because I'm going to be needing you here one of these days, right? But we fail to realize that this is a lifestyle. You see, this is where there's a breakdown in the analogy. Basketball players are basketball players for X number of minutes during a game. And then they walk off the court, and the game is over, right? Now, in truth, they're still a basketball player, and they still represent their team. And so their character does matter because they represent that team both on and off the court. And there is truth that parallels our Christian faith. However, a basketball player's game is over when the bell rings. Not true in our faith. This isn't a one-hour game. This is a lifestyle that we live day in and day out, all day, every day. And friends, people are watching. If you're a parent today, you are being watched. And parents, you are the number one influence in the lives of your children. There is no stronger voice, no greater pull in the heart and in the mind of your young ones than you. Unless you abdicate your authority and your influence, which does happen, okay? But you can win it back. You can win that back if you have done that. So I encourage you to seize that gift that God's given you. If you are a brother or sister today, people are watching you, your siblings. If you're a grandma, a grandpa, an aunt, an uncle, if you're a coworker, if you're a classmate, people are watching you. Everywhere you go and everything you do, they see your example. What do they see? See, every one of us are called to be a disciple maker. And there is no on-court and off-court time in our faith. We're always game on. We don't live two or three different lives. We live one life. And this is part of why the advancement of the kingdom of God has slowed so much in Western cultures, because we have put the fulfilling of the Great Commission, we have put going out and telling people about Jesus, we have isolated that to a special moment called an outreach, right? So when the church does an outreach, maybe this month I can fit that in my schedule and I'll go and be a part of that. And I'll reach out to the community with the good news of Jesus. But in fact, what we understand and learn through Jesus' teachings is that we are on mission all the time. Not just in a moment that we call an outreach, but we live a life of being on mission. That at any moment, at any time, God could use me to be the voice into another life that helps them see God's love for them and understand God's truths in a deeper way. At any moment and at any time, I could be the hands that God is going to use to reach into another life and help them in their time of need. That all that I am, my intellect, my strength, my voice, my money, all my possessions, everything that I am and everything that I have is at God's disposal, so that at any time of day, even 2 a.m, God can use me and God can use you to be his hands, his feet, and to help others come to know Jesus. See, Jesus has called us, he's actually commanded us to live this lifestyle. When he said go, we commonly isolate this scripture to solely be used in the context of being a missionary. But in fact, it's this life. Go into all the world. How many know that you can only be in one place at one time? Yes. And that's where God wants you to be. So that's your world. And that's where you are to be a witness. That's where you are to be a light. And he's commanded us to live the lifestyle of a disciple on mission. And this happens in everyday life. Too many of us are waiting for an outreach opportunity or event to invite a friend or to go and talk to them about Jesus or introduce them to religion. When in fact, it happens in the normal rhythms of life that we live every day. At work, at play, having friends over for dinner or a game, right? And even inviting them to church on Sunday. You see, we overestimate what God will do on a Sunday morning, and we underestimate what God wants to do in our everyday life. We fail to recognize that God uses the ordinary to do the extraordinary. And we find him doing the extraordinary in the ordinary. So many of us are looking for some neon sign in the sky for God to do something miraculous, when in fact the miracles are happening right under our nose on a regular basis, where God is coordinating this and bringing these people across your path and giving you this sense and understanding about what they're facing and what they're going through and giving you certain words to speak into their life. Because it's in English and because there's an emotion involved, you just think that you're just being a part of the moment with them, when in fact you're being a part of the work of God. Unless we cave into fear, another emotion, and we don't say anything and we don't do anything. So many of us, we're looking for some grandiose thing. We think of Billy Graham crusades, where you've got thousands and thousands of people walking up and falling on their knees and saying, "Jesus, save me." Guess what? That does happen, but that's not normal. Normal is that a friend watches another friend, and then they start to go through things in life, some good things, some bad things, and they start to question. And the friend that they're watching, they notice things about them. They notice a stability. They notice a strength. They notice a peace. They notice that when they go through hard times, they're not destroyed by them. They're not crushed. They notice that when they go through good times, there's something that keeps them anchored to reality, and they don't just drift off into la-la land and destroy themselves with all the good. What is it that brings balance to these people's lives? What is it that brings strength and health and wholeness to their marriage and their family and their finances? And how can I get that? And so in my questioning, I start to ask my friend. And they give me answers. And the answers eventually point me toward the truth and the love that God has for me. And the next thing you know, I'm hearing him. I'm seeing things I didn't see before. I'm understanding what I didn't understand before. And my heart gets softer. Next thing you know, I find myself sitting in a church or a Bible study or something else, and I want to pray a prayer, and I want to follow Jesus because I see what he's done in other people's lives, and something tells me he'll do it in mine. Are you tracking with me so far? That's normal, and yet it's extraordinary. The way that God can uniquely meet each and every person in their own context, in their own story, it's amazing. And how he'll use all of us, as weird and odd as we are, right? With all of our idiosyncrasies and weirdness, he wants to use me. He wants to use you to be his voice, to be his hands, and to be his feet. We see Jesus living out these natural rhythms of life. Notice that there were those occasions where Jesus spoke to the crowds of thousands, but a lot of times he was dealing with small groups of people. Many times he was dealing with individuals, and it was, notice, as he was walking, he crossed paths with this guy. As he was sitting at a well, he met this woman. As he was at a wedding reception, he had these people engage him. Right? Where did he meet Zacchaeus, the tax collector that everybody didn't like? On a walk. We want to see the masses come, but they come by the masses going to them. Jesus said, "Go into all the world." Jesus had these natural rhythms of life. He spent time with God the Father, he spent time with his friends, and he spent time with others. Are we following that same pattern? We spend the time with others, that's in there, because we work every day, so we have others in our lives. We go to events, we have hobbies, we spend time with others. And many times, those others include our friends. The danger is when all we do is spend time with just our friends. And what about time with the Father? You know, our first core value at Open Arms Community Church is prayer. We believe that everything we do should start, run, and end thoroughly saturated in prayer. Why? Because we believe that the thing, this extraordinary work that's done in and through the ordinary is a God work. So it'd be quite silly for us to try to attempt this supernatural work in natural strength and intellect. No, no. If we're going to accomplish this God-sized work, don't you think God ought to be a part of it? So are we spending time with the Father as we see Jesus doing? We refer to these three rhythms of life as up, in, and out. And you're going to find that they are the qualities of a winning team. And as I mentioned earlier, and we're going to very quickly look at the qualities of the winning team, but as we do this, you need to remember, a winning team is composed of winning teammates. So you can't have a winning team unless you have winning teammates. Your strongest, you know, as a team, you're only as strong as your weakest link, your weakest member, is what they always say. And the beauty about a team is where one is weak, another can be strong. But the truth is that if you have somebody that is unhealthy, it will slow or drag the team down. Agreed? So as we talk about the qualities of a winning team, please understand these are also the qualities of a winning teammate, and they must be applied first and foremost individually before you can apply them corporately. So very quickly, look with me at the qualities of a winning teammate. Jesus, we said, has invited or commanded all of us to be on the team and to be contributors on the team. He wants team players. He wants playmakers. He wants every one of us to be a part of his work. And we said the first quality of a winning team and a winning team member is, number one, up. Keeping a right relationship with Jesus. Remember, Jesus said to them, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore, so because of who he is, because of what he has done, that is the outflow. That is the source of why we do what we do and all that we do. Everything we do is birthed out of this reality of who Jesus is and what his position is in the universe and what our position is with him. So do we have a right relationship with Jesus? Are we keeping a right relationship with God? If not, it will create an unhealth in our life, an instability, a weakness. And so we may be out there, we may say we're a team player, a teammate, and we may even be on the court trying to help, but the problem is we're low on energy. We've got no real, we're not strong, we're not healthy, we're not able to give 100%. Notice in 2 Peter chapter 1, it says, grace and peace be yours in abundance through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. Notice it says of and not about. You may even want to circle those. Do you know what that means? It means that you're not to learn about Jesus as though it's secondhand information. You are to learn Jesus. You are to know him, not about him. So the knowledge of God, that's something you possess. It's not just something you learn about, okay? And notice that grace and peace is ours in abundance. So all the promises and blessings of God and the peace of God, that wholeness, that stability, guess what? It's ours in abundance, that means overflowing, more than enough, through our knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. His divine power has given, past tense, it's already been done, has given us everything we need for a godly life. I like an earlier translation that says, everything we need for life and godliness. Whatever we face, whatever we're going to need in life to do God's will and to be who He made us to be, guess what? He's already provided it for us. Notice how? Through our knowledge of Him. Again, of Him, not about Him. Who called us by His own glory and goodness. Can you see how deep, how powerful the work of God on our behalf? And this, that we just barely, in most church services, we just barely scratch the surface of how great God is and all that He's done for us. And if you and I just take those two verses to heart, what a challenge, what an invigorating challenge to try to compel us to go deeper with God. Don't you want to know how? I mean, it just told us that grace and peace and abundance, and then anything and everything we will need for a godly life, for life and godliness, are available to us. Don't we want those things? Well, the question is how bad? No, we talk about being a winner. A winner is what? The guy who crosses the finish line, the guy who scores the points, or the gal, right? Well, how bad do you want it? Bad enough to seek diligently? Bad enough to dig deeper than you've ever dug before? Bad enough to read the Bible? Think about it. Through these, meaning His glory and goodness, He has given us His very great and precious promises, so that through them you may participate in the divine nature, having escaped the corruption of the world caused by evil desires. What that says is absolutely mind-blowing, and I wish I had more time to elaborate on it, but I don't. But here's what I want you to see. You and I get the opportunity to live a whole new life. We get to participate in the divine nature. That means the very nature of God. How? Not because we're so strong or we're so smart, but because of His grace and goodness. Through His many promises, we get to participate. That's your up relationship. In other words, friends, we are to become more and more like Jesus. So if that's not happening, then we may need to take a look at our up relationship with God, okay? Because that is absolutely vital to be a healthy team member and to make sure we're a winning team. The second thing, though, so along with this, let me very quickly say that being a playmaker, then, based on this scripture, requires that, first of all, we know the coach, right? Not know about him. Truth is you can't give what you don't have, and you can't teach what you don't know. So it's important that we know the coach. Secondly, we need to be in submission and trust his leadership. Okay? Don't say, I believe in Jesus, and then go do everything he says not to do. And ignore all the things he says to do. Thirdly, we need to have open communication with the coach. If we're not talking to God and he's not talking back to us and we're not having clear communication on what he wants us to do and how, it's going to be hard to run the plays we need to be running. And lastly, relating to our up relationship, we need to grow in understanding of the rules and objectives of the game. What's really expected of us here? And what can we do? And what can't we do? What are those things that are in line with the mind and the heart of the coach? And what are those things that violate his person? Too many times throughout history, we have seen things said and done in the name of Jesus that do not in any way represent the character and the person of Jesus Christ. We have seen people hurt and even killed in the name of God. And it did not represent Jesus at all. So we need to grow in our understanding of the rules and the objectives of the game. What are those things that are in line with what God wants, and what are those things that violate his person and character and will? All right? So our up relationships. Secondly is our out relationships. This is, you know, recruiting new teammates and farming. This is where Jesus said, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations. This is us connecting with other people and relating with them in such a way as to cause them to want to follow Jesus, to want to be a part of the team. Too many of us, the way we relate with outsiders, the way we relate with non-Christians, turns them off. It doesn't turn them on. It makes them feel like they have an excuse to not want to follow Jesus rather than a reason to follow him, and a compelling reason at that. Notice what Ephesians chapter 5 says. God says, be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Would that describe you and me? Are we making the most of every opportunity? I like one translation says, seizing every opportunity. We already shared with you that roughly 80% of the people in this one particular survey said they'd be open to going to church if they were just simply invited by a friend or family member. 8 out of 10. Now, there are other surveys where that number wasn't quite so high. But 60 to 80% of first-time guests that come to church say that the reason they showed up was because they were asked, simply invited. Roughly 75% of those same numbers were asked by a family member or friend. So when you think, boy, this guy really needs Jesus, I want you to look in the mirror to see the number one source of how he's going to meet him. Because most times what we think is, oh, if only I could get Pastor Mike or Pastor Chris or Pastor Justin to come and talk to this guy. Come and pray with this guy. You know what? He doesn't want to talk to a professional Christian. He wants to talk to somebody that he trusts, someone that he knows, someone that he has watched and seen the story lived out. He's seen the changes. He's seen the stability. He's seen how God has seen you through different things. That's who he wants to talk to. And now for some of the more, intellectual things, sure, bring on the professional. Tell me about Melchizedek. What about the apocalypse? Sure, bring in the professional for that kind of stuff. But day in and day out, you want to know who they want to talk to? You, their friend. Because if you say God spoke to me, if you say God did this, I know you're not making it up. I know there must be something to it, because you're not insane. I know you. You're my friend. And you're not prone to just lying and making up stuff. Are you following me? Make the most of every opportunity. The number one influence in a person's life is family first and friends second. Will we maximize this? We have to live the message. We have to live it when we're inside the church building, and we've got to live it when we're outside the church building. So on and off the court, friends. Now, I want to make something clear, and we're wrapping up with this last relationship, is that a disciple is not merely a convert. A disciple is not somebody that you just get to, all right, I don't want you to go to hell and I want you to go to heaven, so say this prayer. In the name of Jesus, I believe in Jesus. He's Lord of my life. Amen. Boom. All right, you're good. Talk to you later. See you when we all get to heaven. No. No. And then we go back to church. Yeah, let me show you my belt. Another notch. Right? I got 10 converts this week. Oh, yeah? No. This isn't a game. this is not a game at all. This is life and death for eternity, not even just our mortal life and death. This is eternity hanging in the balance here. It's not a game, and it's not numbers so that you can put notches on your belt and show you're a good disciple because you've got X number of converts in your lifetime. No. Jesus won't be impressed with that. He's not interested in how many people you get to say a prayer. He's interested in how many people you get to actually go to heaven with you. Does this make sense? God doesn't care so much about the prayer and whether they said the exact right words as he does what's going on in the heart. And does that person enter into a living, alive, active relationship with the creator of the universe that will transform them and change them both in this world and the next? That's what he cares about. So please understand this last one. A disciple is not just a convert, nor is it just a student where you come and you learn the right things. What's the correct answer? Where are we? Church? Jesus. If we're in high school, it's Darwin. But I'm just joking. So, no, you know, it isn't just accumulating information and then regurgitate it when you have to. That's not discipleship. So notice the third one is our in relationships. This is sharing life with your teammates. Jesus said, teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. And if we're teaching people, we got to be around them. And the teaching that Jesus told us to do, as well as he demonstrated himself, is not just classroom. It's not seminar style. It is, in fact, a lifestyle where we share life together and we show a disciple. The best modern word that we could use to describe what a disciple is would be a mentor relationship. Okay? That's a disciple. Hebrews chapter 10, and in your, there's a typo in your outlines, it says chapter 11, but Hebrews chapter 10, it says, and let us consider and give attentive, continuous care to watching over one another. So notice that spending life, sharing life with your fellow Christians is not something we do haphazardly. It's not something we do with a kind of casual or lax attitude or approach. Notice this is something that is supposed to be quite intentional and intense. Give attentive, continuous care to watching over one another, studying how we may stir up, stimulate, and incite to love and helpful deeds and noble activities, not forsaking or neglecting to assemble together as believers, as is the habit of some people, but admonishing, warning, urging, and encouraging one another, and all the more faithfully as you see the day approaching. Can you see we are to have this active engagement in one another's lives? And here's the very interesting part. Are you ready? Most pastors read this portion of Scripture and talk about how important it is to attend church. And we do see, it does say, not forsaking or neglecting to assemble together as believers. Do you see that? And is that what we're doing here? You can nod your heads and say yes. Not a trick question. Yes. We're gathering together as believers today. However, it is not isolated to church. In fact, the context is that this is to be all the more. Notice the last line. And all the more faithfully as you see the day approaching. So the nearer to the end we get, the more involved our lives and intertwined our lives are to be. Not just seeing one another and high-fiving each other in the name of Jesus, of course, on Sunday, but rather every day, day in and day out. This is the example Jesus set. Notice that his disciples, his followers, they didn't just meet once a week or even twice a week for a midweek Bible study. No, no, they lived with him every day, all day. Everywhere he went, they went. Well, how did the early church do it? Because we know that after Jesus was gone, they didn't walk everywhere Jesus walked, right? So what did they do? Notice Acts chapter 2. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and to the breaking of bread and to prayer. So notice there was a time and a place for them to be instructed in the teachings of God. However, that wasn't all they were devoted to. They were devoted to fellowship. They were devoted to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Notice verse 43. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together. Circle that phrase. All the believers were together and had everything in common. So we know they were together. But what did that look like? Because they didn't all join a commune, okay? They all had their own separate homes. So in what way were they all together? Notice, it tells us, they sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day, circle that phrase, every day they continued to meet together. There it is. Well, in what ways? See, some people, they actually are, in the name of Jesus, violating the teachings of God. They think, well, you know what? I need to draw closer to God, and I'm a Christian. I follow Jesus, so I don't have to go to church to be a good Christian. I don't need to be hanging out with other Christians to be a good Christian. And so they think that they can just read their Bible at home or watch, you know, some TV evangelist on television, and that's good enough. Wrong. We already read in Hebrews 10 that we are to not only not neglect or forsake the assembling together of ourselves, but we're to do it all the more as the clock of earth's existence is winding down. And not only that, but here we see that the example was that every day the believers met together. Notice they met together in the temple courts, and they broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. So when it says they met together every day, I will let you know that we know that there was a 3 o'clock prayer meeting every day at the temple that many Christians attended. In fact, the majority did. So every day they met for prayer. We also know, based on this text in church history, that they every day were spending time with one another outside of the context of prayer or Bible teaching. They were fellowshipping. They were eating meals together. And notice that the result of sharing life together and being there for one another, selling property to meet one another's needs, and living life together, notice that the result was not only did God move supernaturally and do miracles through the apostles, but also note this last sentence, and the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. You want to know why the masses wanted to become Christians? Because they saw God moving among the Christians, and they saw Christians taking care of one another. They saw Christians being kind. In fact, historically, kindness was one of the number one identified qualities of the church in the very beginning. And not just kindness to fellow Christians, but kindness to the non-Christian world, even in death. One of the interesting qualities that caused the Christians to be so well-liked by the normal people of society was the fact that when people died and they couldn't afford burial, the church would take care of their burial because they didn't believe that anybody should just be thrown somewhere. Dumped and have a bad burial experience. But so, you know, here they are showing kindness even in death. Up, out, and in. These are the three qualities. If you and I are going to be that teammate that is a playmaker for the kingdom of God, if we're going to experience God moving in us and through us, then God is going to be moving in the natural rhythms of life. And those rhythms have to include up, out, and in. Our relationship with God, our relationship with those that are not yet Christians, and our relationships with fellow Christians. Notice these qualities apply to both the individuals on the team and the team as a whole. You can't have a strong team if you have weak players, right? So strong players make a strong team. So we start with asking, how does this apply to me? And then we can start asking, how does this apply to our team of Open Arms Community Church? Right? So if I were to get enough guts to step out and ask my neighbor or my family member and invite them to church or invite them over for dinner and then talk to them about Jesus, you know, what do you think if you asked them what they saw in you? What would they say? An outside perspective. Could you describe for me what you see in, as far as me and my relationship with God? What would they answer? Would they see a truly devoted and dedicated person who puts Jesus first in all areas of life? What if we were to ask those same people to give an outside perspective about how I relate with those who are my fellow Christians? What would they have to say? How would they describe my interaction with fellow Christians? And lastly, what would they have to say if we invited them to speak truthfully in what they see and how we treat those who are not Christians? Yes, Lord? I think we just hit the bell. These are the questions that we need to ask ourselves today. Let's think. Because in the end, it doesn't matter what we think about ourselves, right? The Apostle Paul said, I don't even judge myself because my perspective can be skewed. I could think more highly of myself than I ought, or I could think more lowly of myself than I ought. Ultimately, I want to ask the Holy Spirit. I want to ask God. The psalmist David said, Lord, you search me and you know me. And he said, search me, O God, and tell me if there's any wicked way in me. And so that friend that we were just talking about is really your best friend. It's really God that you need to be asking that question to. What does he see in us? Let's pray. Lord God, we just come to you right now. In this series, we have learned that you have an expectation that every member is a player in your kingdom. And that every player is meant to be a playmaker. We're to contribute. And if we're going to contribute, we have to be a healthy and strong people. And we have to be living out this mission, playing our game in the everyday rhythm of life. And we pray that you will help us to do that and to do it well. We ask your Holy Spirit right now to illuminate our lives. Open our eyes and help us to see clearly those three questions that we asked. What is our relationship with God really like? How is it seen and understood? And what is our relationship with our fellow Christians like? And what is our relationship with those who are outside the faith? Are we representing well our Lord? Are we representing well the love and the truth that he lived for, that he taught, that he died for? God, help us to be a people that are more than just students, more than just a people that believe in a certain theology. Help us to be a people that do more than just know about God. Help us be a people that know you, that love you as you love us, and that are fully devoted, wholeheartedly committed to living out this life your way. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.